So if you're not familiar with TestLab Neo, we have a thing called Process Designer where we can make a box flow chart of how we want our data to flow through different processes, which we call methods. And so this method is called extract RPM, and this method is supposed to extract an RPM from a time signal that you feed it. So most typically it's an accelerometer or a microphone response that you have measured on some sort of rotating machinery that you know has some order content. Essentially, almost anything that rotates, whether it's an electric motor or an internal combustion engine or a pump, is going to have some order content based on the construction of the device, what makes it spin, and what kind of output it's generating. So we're feeding this method time signal, and we're going to get out an RPM curve that it's going to estimate for us from the data. What we have to tell it is we're going to say, hey, look at this color map. It's going to calculate a color map behind the scenes, and it's going to see these squiggly lines. If we tracked versus time, the RPM may not be going up perfectly linearly. And we're going to say, look in this general vicinity for a maximum of the trace where the amplitude is the highest. And we're going to give it a starting point either in frequency and time or RPM and time. So we're going to say, in this general vicinity, find the maximum and then track it for the rest of my data. And I think that's going to be, in this instance, second order. So, in order for this to work, you need to have some familiarity with your device, at least rudimentary knowledge about how many pistons there are in the pump, or how many poles there are on the magnet of the electric motor, how many cylinders there are in your combustion engine, that sort of thing. Now, you can play some games and sort of iterate on this until you get it correct, but if you know what some of the order content should be, you can do this more quickly. So we're going to specify the channel to look at, which would be this response here, and then the order we're asking it to find, and then sort of where to start. And we're going to specify an initial value like we talked about, either an RPM or a frequency and a time. And that's going to be a starting point for the algorithm. Now, if you don't know a specified starting value, which sometimes I think you might, depending on how you're testing this machine. A lot of times you have a test bench, right, where you're always running sort of highly controlled sweeps. So on a chassis dyno or some sort of electric motor test stand, you often say, I want to run up for a given load. I want to run from 1,000 RPM up to 8,000 RPM over 60 seconds. And you're going to do that via the dyno controls in a very repeatable manner. And so if that's your situation, you might know, okay, at, for instance, 1 second, we're always around 1,000 RPM. So that's all you have to tell it. Now, if you're just measuring a vehicle on the road or something that isn't so highly controlled, you can first calculate the spectrum map. And this is what happens in TestLab Classic, is you generate the spectral map and then sort of investigate it graphically. You can do the same thing in TestLab Neo. You just calculate the spectrum versus time, and you see some order content, and you place a cursor kind of close to what you think of as the maximum for that order. Okay, we can see some orders here, both positive and negative, and we just place a cursor and we get a frequency and a timestamp from that cross cursor. We put those into the parameters pane. So in this case, our initial value, we'd say we're going to specify a frequency. We're going to put in 2461. Okay, and then a starting time of 7.5 seconds. And this tolerance is the percentage of the starting frequency or RPM if we had specified RPM. And so in this case, it's going to look over 10% of 20,000 hertz or 2,000 hertz, and it's going to center that right where we started. So it's going to go down 1,000 hertz, and it's going to go up about 1,000 hertz. And it's going to look anywhere in that band for a maximum. So you don't have to be incredibly accurate with your initial values, provided you only have primary order in here, where you're going to have one maximum over this band it's going to look in. It will pretty much always figure it out. Now, if you know, like we were saying, with a simple run up or a run down in a controlled environment, you can just specify an RPM and a timestamp. And that's how I'll show you in this first example. We're going to pretend it's from a pretty regular test stand. Okay, default tolerance is 50%, but obviously you can specify that to whatever you deem appropriate. And we'll show you what it looks like in TestLab Neo. So I'm going to start, I'm going to cheat a little bit. I'm going to start with a run-up that has a taco, and I'm going to replace it in my input basket. And you can see I have both a trace that's a taco as well as a response trace. So for this first section, I'm going to pretend I don't have this taco, and I'm going to try to extract it from this data here and see what happens. So I first want to create a new method using extract RPM. So I just start typing RPM up here and I get the extract RPM method. So I just connect my input to that method, and I like to make sure that they're flowing into the right part of the box because I'm specific like that. And I click on the method and I now have some properties that I can specify about that method. So the quantity in this case, it is an acceleration based on the response trace that I have. I can now specify the point ID or the DOF ID that is 0.1. That is this guy down here. So I want you to look at degree of freedom 0.1. This should be third order, is primary. There's no order offset, but we'll come back to that in just a minute. And now I have to specify this initial initial value. And I'm gonna say this is one of those instances where I'm on a test stand. Again, I'm always running the same sort of run up on this engine, and it's always from about 600 RPM up to about 3600 RPM over 20 seconds or so. And so from my background, I know we're almost always right around 1000 Hertz at 1 second. Again, I'm gonna use a 50% tolerance there, but I'm just gonna say, go ahead and grab that for me using that initial value. And I'm gonna call this the extracted RPM. That's the output of this method. It'll be a new point ID called extracted RPM. And let's run this guy and see what happens. Now, in Neo, I don't have to just run that result and save it, and it's building up the size of my project. I can just go to the active, all the results that I get out of a run process go to a holding area called active analysis, where I can look at them and see if they're what I want. So if I click on active analysis, my pivot table updates, and I see I have this extracted RPM. Oh, look at that. It calculated roughly 700 to about 3600 RPM. That seems awfully reasonable, but to double check, I happen to have a get out of jail free card here, and that is an actual taco that I measured. So if I overlay those, I see that good agreement between those two. So I verify that the method works. In this case, I had an actual taco. I measured it. I wanted to see if the extraction method worked. It did. So let's say I don't have a taco and I want to maybe do this a little bit more graphically because I don't really have the taco and I don't know so much about it. I can now add onto this extract RPM, I can add the spectrum map, and I'm going to now be able to build this spectrum map out of the extracted RPM. Now, if I happen to know, again, that the test bench always runs it up to about 1000 RPM at 1 second, I can just run this and I will get a spectral map, and I can look at that in my display here, and I can come over here and say format, oops, axis, go to extracted RPM. And to verify this worked, I can just throw on a single cursor and say it's an order cursor. And if I say move this order cursor to third order, if this lines up with a nice line in my plot, then that gives me, again, confirmation that I accurately calculated this order. If I do that, boom, looks pretty good to me. So that gives me confirmation that the order cursor lines up with the order response in my response time data. And so that, again, gives me a nice warm fuzzy. But again, let's say I want to go one step beyond that. And so I'm going to add an order section onto that spectral map. And so now I'm going to say, all right, use this extracted RPM to calculate a spectral map, and then use that spectral map to cut some order sections and see if some of my other known order content shows up and lines up, again, giving me further confirmation. So I can run this, but here I'm going to change my orders. I don't want to use, well, I want to do a bunch of orders. 1, 1.5, 2, 2.5, 3. So I'm going to cut these five orders and there's no offset. And so now I'll get an order section with each of those five orders and I'll be able to compare those directly to my spectral map. Again, in a verification effort to make sure I'm extracting the correct method. And you see I get an error. It's because I skipped a step here. Because I'm using data that happens to have a real taco, I can't leave the channel selection mode in automatic. I would need to say, look for rotational speed, and I need to specify I want you to use the extracted RPM. Automatic just says, I'm assuming I'm only going to find one taco channel in there. And if it does only find one, then obviously it knows which one to use. In this case, it finds two, so it needs me to specify. And so I need to change it like this, and I get the ability to run. Again, I go to this active analysis. I see my spectrum map here. I'm going to remove that cursor. And now I'll take my order sections and I'm going to optimize that, zoom out a little bit. Oops. And then I can drop my five order sections down here. And voila, I get a nice confirmation that the known order content for this machine, I know it produces half order content in this case, and I see all of those orders are matching up. So if I had guessed incorrectly and this wasn't really third order, it was really fourth order, then the RPM will be off in such a way that fourth order might line up, but these other orders that I calculate that are harmonics or partial harmonics of that order will not be correct because the calculated RPM won't exactly be right. And so this is just a nice confirmation that, again, I'm getting the correct RPM value and that the algorithm is working as intended. So that's pretty straightforward. One of the other cool things that was added in Neo with this new method is the ability to add an offset. And you've seen me kind of skip over that selection criteria. But if I were to have a new sort of signal, let me go back here to my list and get this guy and put him in my input basket. And this is going to be an electric motor with a PWM control. This will not have just your typical sort of go through zero orders. You'll also have orders that have an offset or are both positive and negative off some higher frequency. And so the response isn't going to help me much, but if I'm going to first, I don't know what frequency I need to give it or initial value. So I'm going to bypass my extract RPM and I'm going to send this data right to the spectral map. I'm going to turn this guy off for now also. And I'm just going to do that initial sort of investigation of this response and see what I get in terms of a spectral map and see if that helps me clue in on where I want to specify my initial value. So I look at my spectral map and, oh yeah, I've got some cool, way different stuff here, right? I have some, you know, go through zero orders, classic stuff, but I also have these weird triangular V-shaped orders. And this is very typical for an electric motor where you have a pulse width modulated signal that's doing the speed control or the torque control for an electric motor. So if I zoom in down here, and I'm going to actually put this into my color map display so I can have some results that stick with me. So I'll do that same zoom in here. And these are the orders that I want to track. And I know that I'm looking for a 16th order in this case, based on the number of poles in my motor and what I know about the pulse width modulation signal that I'm using to control. So I'm going to add a cross cursor here and go like that. And now I just have to sort of place it at what I consider to be the maximum or close. So I'm going to grab this and I'm going to put it right about there. And I'm just trying to get it somewhere in the middle of this order line I see here. Okay, so now I have a time and a frequency that I can use to specify my initial values for my extract RPM method. So I'm going to go back here. And the reason I put this color map into a dedicated color map display as opposed to the preview display is I need to reject this result in order to get access to the process that I used. Okay, so I like to keep a copy of that. Even though I rejected the results of that, because I put it into a display, I get to keep looking at that. So now with my extract RPM method, I can click here and you see it's updated. It now knows that this is a pressure response as opposed to an acceleration. And if you're a user of Neo, I think you'll notice that that is also a new functionality. So in our processing, there is this automatic dry run feature where it is always updating the process and sort of dry running, not actually producing any calculated results, but going to the input basket, seeing what data types I have, channel IDs, all of that stuff, and sort of running it through the processes from data type, descriptions, things like that, and doing what we call a dry run. So now all I have to do is go to this extract RPM. It knows it's a pressure. It automatically knows the new DOF IDs. I don't have to do any of this run to that you may have been doing before. So I select the response of my channel here, and I know that I'm looking for 16th order. And now I'm going to use this order offset. The order offset is, in this case, 20 kilohertz. And I'm going to use an initial setting or initial value of frequency, and I'm going to look at my cursor and say 2514. I'm going to say at 6.3 seconds, and I'm not going to leave this tolerance quite so high. And the reason is because when I'm dealing with a PWM order, it has this other order pretty close in frequency. And so if I leave this at 50%, it's going to look at 50% of 20 kilohertz. So it's going to use a 10,000 hertz wide band centered right here. And it's going to include a bunch of stuff, including this other maximum that I don't want it to find. So I'm going to restrict this tolerance much smaller. And so now instead of 10,000 hertz, I'm going to be looking over essentially 1,000 hertz above and below. And now I have much more confidence that this is going to be the only sort of local maximum within that. Okay, so I'm going to say start at 20 kilohertz, 6.5 seconds or so, and look up and down about 1,000 hertz wide. Okay, I'm going to still call it extracted RPM, and also going to do my final check, which is I'm going to calculate some orders just like I've been doing. And the rotational speed I will use again, but it is also going to be this extracted RPM. But here I'm not going to pick those orders. I want to do these two orders, and they also have an offset of 20 kilohertz. Okay. So let's see how I do here. So I run this process, it's already done. And now if I look in my color map, I'm going to remove my cursors here. And this is already my spectrum map. So I can take my two order sections and I can drop them in here and boom. So this gives me confirmation that I've extracted the correct RPM. I've then used that extracted RPM to calculate some order cuts for this PWM control frequency, which as I happen to know is plus and minus 16th order off that 20 kilohertz carrier frequency. So you notice I didn't have to do any saving of the extracted RPM signal, didn't have to go back to Navigator and reload new time data, all of that sort of jumping around that is part of the way Classic works. I don't have to do any of that. And so I think there's a real benefit to how these methods work in TestLab Neo. I'm a big fan of TestLab Neo. So if you're not quite up to speed on it, I suggest you look into it, and we are always happy to help get you started.